Thank you, Alf. As Alf said, I'm a doctorate student in film studies here at the department. I will talk under the title New Film Historical Research Beyond the National Archive. And I'm departing both from my ongoing dissertation project with the working title, or directly translated from the Swedish working title, but Film in Service of the City, Municipal Audiovisual Media Use in Gothenburg, 1938 up until 2015. In this presentation, I will, however, mostly focus on a kind of methodological problem, or how to deal with film historical research beyond the cinema and so on. And I'm basing this presentation on an article I wrote this autumn in Journal of Scandinavian Cinema, who had a special issue about the role of the archive in film historical research. A very long and clumsy title, but you can read it there. So one can say that the field that I'm placing my dissertation project within is a kind of new historical interest in within film studies in the last 10 or 15 years or so, where many researchers have moved from the feature fiction film and from the cinema as the main screening context, studying films outside of the cinema, for example, in this anthology, Swedish anthology that came out 2007, Swedish film outside of the cinema, but also, or part of this, films produced by companies and by business organizations and so on, so-called industrial film, for example, in this English anthology from 2009, Films That Work. And especially this anthology has, the title of this anthology, Useful Cinema. This has become a kind of umbrella term for all kinds of film that is not to be seen as just as aesthetical objects, but films that have been produced to do things within organizations or municipalities or companies or schools and so on, produced to be useful, so to speak. And one of the more, there has been many anthologies published in the last decade or so, but just recently this Claire Thompson's book on Danish informational cinema in the post, in the mid and post-war period is kind of one of the more, the bigger studies in this field. So the term useful cinema then is films produced on commission by industries, organizations, municipalities, governments, and so on, and produced to be useful, to fulfill an aim within the commissioning organization, to document an industrial process, or instruct workers, or teach school children, or these kind of tasks, or as a commercial for a commercial or information film, in my case, for the city of Gothenburg, and with certain target groups in mind, schools or industries or school tourists and so on. And these kind of films, at least the field of useful cinema is, of course, very varied in many senses. But the kind of film that I'm studying were both screened at cinemas, but were also screened in other contexts outside of the cinema. And they also are characterized by a kind of what I call textual instability, that many films were, film material were reused between different films and recuts, and there were tailored versions aimed for specific target groups. So it's not this kind of fixed filmic text, which is usually is when you're studying fiction films. Of course, there can be a director's cut or so on, but normally you know what you're talking about when you say a specific title. So this field you move from studying just the film itself, it becomes crucial to also studying the production background. Who commissioned this film? Why was it made? Who was it intended for? Where was it screened? And so on. So you need to kind of contextualize a film with a broader archival material. And it's here that I'm arguing that you need to move beyond the traditional film archive. Film history has traditionally been written from the national level and from the archives at the national level. In Sweden, mainly the Swedish Film Institutes has been the main Swedish film archive, and also from where film history in Sweden has been written. But the Swedish Film Institute's archive is mainly devoted to feature films screened at cinemas, or in some cases also shorter films that were screened in cinemas. But the National Archives is often very focused on this kind of fixed and isolated text and not really structured for this kind of messiness of useful cinema, where the same film title can be found in many different versions and so on, and recuts and so on. So new types of archives become essential for studying useful cinema. And I will exemplifying this and also the kind of broader interest in useful cinema must be understood in relation to the digital development of the last 15 years and so, that many of these films were kind of forgotten in the archives, but with digitization, they can be studied again. And I want especially to discuss this site, filmarkivet.se. I don't know how many of you who are familiar with this site. Some, at least. But it's a collaboration between the Swedish Film Institute and the Natural Library in Sweden for making this kind of films available to a broader audience. So you can find different kind of short and documentary films and commercial films and many films that can be, I would argue, can be labeled as kind of useful cinema. However, there's little knowledge about this film and exactly these kind of questions. Who commissioned and financed them? Why were they made? Who were they, their intended audience? Where were they screened and so on? This information lacks on this page, and I think this information is really crucial for understanding these films. So we have a lot of films, but we don't really know that much about them. And of course it's understandable because it's a new research area and so on. But the site has gotten some critique from a number of film scholars. Pelle Snickers, for example, called it a failed film archival project and argued that the site doesn't really, it has failed to balance a kind of more public interest in just watching the fun films from the past and a more research interest for getting more knowledge about the films and also for combining the films with other types of archival material. It's no possibility for connecting a film with contextualizing material, so they are very isolated and so on. And Ingrid Stigsdotter has also argued that it's constructed from a national perspective, although saying that it's now we're writing the Swedish film history in a new perspective, but it's written from the national perspective and also from the holdings in the national archives, which of course affects what kind of national film history that can be written on the site. And Andersson, Sundholm and Söderberg Widding argues precisely as I do that the site has too much focused on fixed and isolated filmic texts. They write about some of the experimental films that are available on site and saying that it's hard to talk about just one single film. You must understand them as a more as a process and as a well, what is screened and all of this. So they want to see more of these many versions of the film and so on. And I'm going to exemplify this with one of the films that are available on the site that is also part of my dissertation project. Göteborg, Hjärtpunkt I Norden, Gothenburg, it has an English title. Gothenburg at the Heart of Scandinavia from 1964. So this film, since it was screened in cinemas, this film is available both in the Swedish Film Institute's archive and also digitized on this site for everyone to see. But we have very little information about the film. It's the film itself, there's no information that it was commissioned by the municipality in Gothenburg. So I had to dig into the archives here in Gothenburg to understand that it actually is a commercial / information film for Gothenburg. Or actually they call it a propaganda film in the discussion. So in the municipal board, they started to discuss this project 2 years before it was finished in 1962, and a special working group was established to discuss the production of propaganda for Gothenburg. The production of propaganda is seen as a most important task for Gothenburg's development. With the expected changes due to the expanding European market at hand, one has been able to see a rising activity in a number of Swedish and European cities. Since all experiences show that propaganda measures for locating industries and business companies are long-term issues, the production of a possible goodwill film should be planned at the moment of writing. And I think this quote is interesting in many ways, but first of all, that the word propaganda was still used about your own activities still in the 1960s. It didn't have this kind of negative connotations. And also this, that film was the medium to use for producing propaganda about Gothenburg. And it was a real big project from the municipality's side. And it was mainly financed by the municipality, but local industries such as Volvo and SKF were invited to contribute economically to the film. And in exchange, they would get tailored versions, so you would see a bit more of the Volvo industries in the Volvo version of the film. And I haven't really been able to trace how many different versions, if Volvo really got their own version. But I have been able to trace that two different versions were made, one mainly aimed at tourists and one mainly aimed at industries. And both of these versions were screened at cinemas in Sweden for around 1 year each. And they were also screened in a number of other venues, including schools around Sweden. So you can find this film in school film catalogs from the mid-1960s until the late 1970s. And it also has a broad international distribution of both these films. So in the archive here in Gothenburg, in the regional archive, I have found a number of different language versions of this film. In Swedish and the Finnish version, and with English speaker and Dutch and German and French and so on. So summing up, I'll argue then that the kind of the infrastructure on the national level is not really suited for studying these kind of films beyond the cinema, the feature fiction film. And this kind of multiple versions, aim target groups and screening contexts and so on. And especially I think this film that I talked about, it's really interesting that it start as a kind of propaganda project for Gothenburg for attracting industries, but then it ends up in schools. So it really has many different aims and target groups. and also that the international non-cinematic distribution of the film is not really possible to tell in the National Archives, because there you only have the version that was screened at cinemas, but you don't find the other versions, or you don't see that it's also had a broad international distribution. So the local archive kind of puts the holdings of the National Film Archives in a new light. And also then that the digital development and digitization projects such as filmarkivet.se kind of highlights these issues. But at the same time, it would be, I mean, you can see the possibility for a site such as filmarkivet.se, which Andersson, Sundholm and Söderberg-Widing also argues, that it's precisely this kind of digital medias that could capture this kind of messiness of useful cinema. So you could have many different versions of the same film, and you could combine it with other types of archival material and so on, and use filmic and non-filmic material from different archives, and to place the film within its broader social and political context within which it were produced, circulated and exhibited. Yeah, I'm finished. I don't know if I was a bit early, but